Hello, everyone. This is Joakim from Sabaton, and you're listening to the Cassius Morris Show. Take care and see you on the road.
Hey, everybody. Just wanted to let you know that this podcast now has a new sponsor, Amazon.com. If you go to thatreporterkid.com and click the Amazon tab at the top of the page, it redirects you to Amazon.com normally. However, when you purchase something on the website, it helps support the show. That's right. No extra price for you, and it sends a kickback our way to help keep us going, and it's very much appreciated. So thatreporterkid.com and click on the Amazon tab at the top of the page and enjoy the show.
Hi, everybody. It's Duncan Trussell, and that reporter kid is a freaking genius.
Hey, everybody. This is Marty Friedman, and you are listening to That Reporter Kid.
Yo, this is Joey Cookwood-Beers, and you're listening to That Reporter Kid, bitches. Stay black.
Hey, this is Brian Redband of Death Squad Studios, and you are listening to That Reporter Kid. If you don't know you're listening to it right now, then never mind. You might want to just move on.
What's going on, guys? Cassius Morris, a.k.a. That Reporter Kid here, and you are listening to The Cassius Morris Show. I am your host. Today is Tuesday, November 4th, 2014. It is 10:23 p.m., and I'm recording here from the Basement Broadcast Center in Edmonton, Alberta. Wow, I felt so professional doing that intro. It's the first time I really nailed it on the second take. I am doing this recording right before finishing my notes for tomorrow's Adam Carolla Show with Norman Lear, television legend. And come to think of it, that's probably why you guys are here right now, because you heard me on that or the last Adam Carolla Show. So I'm not sure how it went yet, because this is past me talking to future you, but I'm sure it went awesome and it was a lot of fun. So thank you for coming over if you are coming over from the Adam Carolla Show. And thank you to my listeners for listening if you're just sticking around. We have a very special show today. And actually, speaking of the listeners, I'm going to be honoring you guys today. I decided to have a call-in show. All call-ins, and we got a lot of callers. Also, I have Joakim from Sabaton calling in, as you heard in the beginning of the episode. Sabaton is an awesome Swedish metal band. They're great. They have a really, really unique sound, and I'm going to play the interview with him coming very soon. So first off, I just wanted to give a couple announcements about what's going on with the show. Tomorrow, I do the Adam Carolla Show, which, again, you already heard. And then the day after, I do a interview with Adam on this show. So the next episode of this show will be an interview with someone. I'm not sure who yet, along with Adam. Maybe somebody from a band. I'm not going to say exactly who, because I'm not sure for sure. But there's going to be two interviews, and one of them is going to be Adam Carolla, folks. So if you're coming over from his show, I'm sure you heard, but Adam is going to be doing my show. I see it kind of like a birthday present, because tomorrow is my 16th birthday, and it's pretty interesting. You know, I'm spending it alone in a way. I mean, I have my friends around. I mean, sorry, my family around, but the friends aren't there since I did just make the move cross country. So it's interesting. I tried to go to a comedy show today alone, mostly so I didn't have to talk to anybody and I could really soak in the comic that was going on and kind of take mental note of what he was doing. I've wanted to do that for a while and didn't get admitted because my 16th is tomorrow and it's 16 is the age limit. So that kind of sucked, but I'm trying to make the best of the situation. I do have this podcast today. I have Adam Carolla 2 days in a row, which is a thrill. Again, you know, he was one of the, if not the first podcast I ever listened to, and he turned me on. Without Adam Carolla, I would have never heard Joe Rogan, Death Squad, Ari, you know, any of these guys, Duncan, Joey, who I think are technically Death Squad, but I would have never heard any of them without Adam Carolla. I would have probably never advanced from 10-year-old me properly while doing this if it wasn't for Adam Carolla. Huge influence on me. So it's an honor that he was interested in having me back on his podcast, which is absolutely a shock. You know, it's not like it was his team. It was him who was expressing the interest. So I'm doing my best to make some funny, get in a funny headspace, I guess, so that I can crack some jokes, shed some awareness for this podcast, and enjoy myself on his. It's fantastic. I feel like the podcast is on an upswing right now. And things are just getting better. I feel it. You know, it's when an episode has a buzz, it's almost like I can feel the buzz within me. I can feel how the episode's doing just by thinking about it. When I check the numbers, it usually matches that. But when I release something that I feel like people are going to be interested in, it feels good. And if I feel that response from the internet, it's like it comes through the monitor. And that is, you know, kind of ridiculous to say, but that's how it feels. I feel all the positive feedback that's tweeted to me. It improves my day and it makes me feel fantastic. So thank you guys all for all the kind tweets and emails. I got an email from a guy in the Netherlands, which I will read on the next episode the other day. People in California, a lot of them Adam Carolla fans. So thank you guys all so much. So let's get into the interview with Joakim from Sabaton. Let me just say, this guy is an incredible singer, but he's also, his speaking voice is so damn cool. I just want him on overdubbed on every commercial ever. I mean, Vincent Price, anything. Just overdub Joakim from Sabaton. This guy has a fantastic voice, and I could listen to him talk for hours. Unfortunately, we only got to have him for 20 minutes, but I thoroughly enjoyed talking to him. We talked about torrenting and pirating music, which is a topic I'm really interested in, especially when I talk to musicians and people from bands. And it's really interesting, his take on it. I'm going to save it for the interview, but he thinks it's not all that bad. We're going to talk about that right now with Joakim from Sabaton, and then we're going to come back with you guys' calls here on the Cassius Morris Show.
Hey, this is Cassius.
Yes, how are you?
All good, and you?
I'm fantastic. Thank you so much for calling in. I know there was a couple scheduling issues, but thank you again.
No problem at all.
Awesome. So, ladies and gentlemen, Joakim from Sabaton. So tell me, where are you calling in from today?
St. Louis.
Okay, you guys are on tour?
Yes, very much so.
Okay, so how's the tour going?
It's good, actually, so far. I mean, we're on the road with them on a month right now, so we're having a great time. Lots of Swedish people on the same tour package is always nice.
Yeah, right, I'd imagine. And you guys are from Sweden. There seems to be a huge market for metal out there, right?
Yeah, I mean, Sweden is a small country, but percentage-wise, I'd say pretty much yes.
What do you think that is?
Well, what else is there to do in the wintertime when it's dark and cold?
Except for rock
either out. Either you drink or you play metal. That's it.
Seriously, right? So tell me about how you got into the band Sabaton. How did you guys form?
Basically, back in 99, we didn't have the tie in name Sabaton at that point, but an old schoolmate of mine brought me in and said, he's playing with a band. They need a keyboarder, which is how I started out in the band, actually. And then it turns out that they didn't even have a singer, and I wrote songs, and then, can you sing until we find a singer? And then they're lazy because they still haven't found a fucking singer.
So that's how it happened.
Yeah, I mean, back in those days, I mean, nobody had any plan. We were just a bunch of guys who liked to, you know, listen to Judas Priest, Painkiller, or, you know, Keeper of the Seven Keys and getting drunk together. And, I guess that influenced us into performing the kind of music we do today.
Right. And were you guys influenced by Metallica as well? Because I heard you guys cover For Whom the Bell Tolls. That was awesome, by the way.
Oh, thanks. I mean, I always liked Metallica. I mean, personally, I think everybody in the band does like them. And I mean, this song we did a cover of For Whom the Bell Tolls is about military history, which is right up our alley as well. And if I'm not mistaken, that was also the first song our bass player ever played on stage. So we figured, hey, back to memory lane.
Wow, that's very cool. Another thing I wanted to know was, there is a lot of stuff going on online. I mean, if you look up any album, pretty much, or song by any, mostly metal bands and any other band, you can find it on YouTube, torrent sites. How do you feel about people torrenting music? Is it wrong?
Well, to be honest, it depends on the situation. I mean, if you're already making a lot of money and you can't actually afford to buy the music, yeah, please do. Or, I mean, there's Spotify or Pandora Radio. There are proper channels to get music for free or pretty much for free. On the other hand, I mean, if you are from the Ukraine, where you can't even get a proper, you know, what do you call it?
CD?
Edition anyway. Yeah, you can't get the proper CD because it'd be bootlegged anyway. Why pay for it? You know what I mean?
Right.
I'd rather have people listening to our music than not doing it, even if we're not getting paid.
Okay.
But on the other hand, somebody trying to make money out of our music, that's a total different story.
Of course, yeah. And that's what some people say. Like, I heard Paul Stanley the other day. He was saying that it doesn't matter if you're a young Kiss fan, per se, and you download the songs because you can't get them, or if you are rich and you do it, it's the same thing. But you're coming from the point of view where if you can't actually get it properly and you want to, you have a love for the music and you want to hear it, that's all right.
Yeah, I pretty much agree with him on that.
Right. So you don't think that this kind of stuff is killing rock and metal?
Well, in a sense, I don't think it would kill it if everybody lived by those rules, if you know what I mean.
Right, yeah. Everybody's got to get on the same page.
Exactly. And as soon as everybody who could actually afford a music album would actually buy it, I mean, digitally or, you know, even listening to, you know, Spotify, illegal streaming services, whatsoever. Because, to be honest, nobody can come and say albums are expensive.
Yeah.
They're not. I mean, they don't cost any more now than 10 years ago.
12, 13 bucks.
Yeah.
That's about
which
it.
Is, you know, how much of an increase in price have you seen on albums compared to 10 years ago? Compared to a McDonald's fucking burger.
Right, not a whole lot.
No, it's quite, you know, it's actually decreased in some areas in the world. So the thing is, now it's offered for free. You know, you couldn't get it for free earlier. So I don't think, if you actually have the money to go out, get drunk and, you know, you know, spend money on other stuff, then you could afford an album. On the other hand, if you don't have the money, and if you can't access the music, sure, do it.
Right. So I think there should be some kind of adjustment to these laws because they're very, you know, black and white. Maybe if people saw it that way, there'd be less of a problem.
I mean, to be honest, an album's going to cost you 3 beers. Seriously?
Right. You're going out buying Booker's, buying beers. You can buy a Sabaton CD.
Exactly.
So speaking of records, take me back. Talk to me about when you first got your record deal with Sabaton.
Oh, well, we had three different ones, actually, over the years. The first one was with an Italian metal label. This is back in 2001. And let's just say we will never deal with these people again. They're,
okay.
You know, all kinds of strange excuses. No, we can't release your album today because there's a heat wave going on in Italy. And then there was his cousin's wedding, which is a big thing. And yeah, then their favorite football team or soccer for you guys team lost. Yeah, all of this. So we left as soon as we could, actually.
Really?
We recorded one album with them, which was never released, actually. Then we went to a Swedish record label, which were good. I'm not going to complain about them at all. The thing was, though, they were only powerful in Sweden. And then, you know, the further away from Sweden you got, the weaker they became.
Okay.
For obvious reasons, independent label.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, we released a couple of albums with them, and we bought back the album from the first record label, the Italian fuckers. And in 2010, we signed up with Nuclear Blast.
Okay, and that's where you guys are now. So that's kind of a shame because you guys, you know, must have been really excited for your first record deal, and then you're sitting there getting screwed around by the label.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, we were really, really pissed back then. But these days, we're looking at it like a blessing in disguise because we learned when the stakes weren't that high that, all right, wait. Nobody's going to do this. We got to take control of our futures ourselves, of our music. We're not going to wait for the labels to put up the money. We're going to invest our own money and then sell an album to a record label, and then we can set the terms and stuff like that.
Okay, so is that advice you would give to up-and-coming bands right now?
Yes and no, depending on what deals. I mean, obviously, there has to be an interest for you before you can ever do that. But
right.
In general, recording stuff isn't that expensive. If you have somebody in the band with a lot of know-how or, you know, you get somebody, you know, that a friend that can mix very good for free or, you know, cheap, mm-hmm. yes, it is better to come with, you know, 8 to 12 very, very good song on a CD. Hey, guys, this is ready to be released.
Right. As long as they're interested. That,
yeah, exactly. And, you know, at that point, you take the business side gamble out of the equation. Because if they only heard two songs or three songs from a demo, they know how the rest is going to be like.
Right.
Now, at least the label, you know, the band would be talking to in this case would have, you know, all the facts on the table. Okay. This is the music.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
To be honest, though, not many record labels will invest in a band today that's not touring. So.
Right. Well, it's very difficult, you know, as we discussed earlier, to make money in this kind of thing. Especially if you're up and coming now. I mean, '99 was different, but you know, this is 2014. It gets more difficult, right?
Yep.
So, you guys get signed on for your record label. You get everything sorted out. You know, there are a lot of Swedish metal bands. I find that you guys stand out in a good way. Is it hard to be different from all of these other metal bands and have your own style?
I don't know. I mean, we weren't really that different in the beginning. It's something that came. I think, I don't know why that is, actually, but I started out, you know, playing Hammond church organ. Even though I'm not religious at all, I always loved the sound of a powerful church organ, or Hammond organ for that matter. And a lot of our, you know, choirs, the way we harmonize them and all of that, that is actually, you know, basically, yeah, Christian tradition.
Right.
Psalms and stuff like that, how they would have the stuff,
okay,
arranged. So, I mean, that gives us a little bit of a different thing. So, yeah, I call it a bit mix of between Martin Luther and Accept, you know. And then you probably have it.
Yeah, and I think it's fantastic, by the way. I mean, Sabaton has a huge following. Can you tell me about the biggest festival or concert you guys ever played?
Yeah, that's the one. We actually got it on DVD. It's in Poland. Polish Woodstock is the name of the festival. 600,000 people.
Wow, that must have been crazy.
That was crazy, but you know, at a certain point, it, for all that I could see, I mean, it could have been half there, and I wouldn't know the difference.
Right, because of the lights.
Yeah, and I mean, even if they light it all up, people are standing on the other side of a hill watching a screen, seeing our show.
They're like, it's good enough. It's Sabaton.
Yeah, so it was crazy. I mean, to be honest, 600,000 people. If you would take that festival area and put it in the middle of Sweden, it will be the second biggest densely populated area in Sweden.
Wow. That's incredible. So it really is that small.
Yeah, I mean, we're 9 million or 10 million people.
Wow, and there's like 3 million in the city next to me, so I can imagine. Well, no wonder that they have such a, you know, kind of brotherhood when it comes to their music.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's more people in New York City than all of Sweden.
Wow. That's incredible.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think it's a fantastic thing that all these Swedish rock bands are doing, including you guys. Where can people check out Sabaton on the web, by the way?
Well, sabaton.net is the easiest way. I mean, you get links to everything there.
Yeah.
Otherwise, if you got Spotify or any of these streaming services, I mean, feel free to use them.
Okay.
So, and I mean, there's always YouTube. And I, to be honest, if you can't find us legally, I have no moral, nothing moral against anyone checking us out the piracy way, if you know what I mean.
Okay. Well, that's very interesting, your thoughts on that. I appreciate you sharing with me and coming on. Thank you so much. And if you guys ever come through Edmonton, I would love to see the show.
All right. We'll be there, I think, quite... No. Actually, we just been there.
Oh, I see. I just moved here, so I missed it.
All right.
Well, thank you so much for your time. I hope to see you soon.
You too, man. Take care.
Okay, bye. Joakim from Sabaton, folks. Very, very cool guy. It was insane to talk to. Again, a guy with such a kick-ass voice, and he's in a kick-ass band. They're really cool. Make sure to check out Sabaton's last record, Heroes. It was released with Nuclear Blast Records. Awesome record. Really cool. Next show, we have a band member from the band Requiem, which is going to be on there. Actually, you know what? I might just stick it in there right now. It's 10 minutes. Since we just played a metal interview, and we probably still have some metal fans sticking around, before we get to some calls, let's speak to Requiem right now. Here is Jacklyn Paulette. Make sure to check out Requiem's latest record, The Unexplainable Truth, in stores everywhere now. They also just released a new music video, Sticks and Stones and Her Lovely Bones. Make sure to check out the record on Spotify, Amazon, iTunes. And speaking of Amazon, you can go to thatreporterkid.com, click on the Amazon tab, and buy their latest record, The Unexplainable Truth, and support the show at the same time. Same with Sabaton. If you want to buy some Sabaton albums or anything related to the band, thatreporterkid.com, Amazon tab at the top of the page, and support the show. So here is Jacklyn Paulette from Requiem, and we will be right back. Listener calls right after this. Hey, how you doing?
Calling about the interview. Good, how about you?
Oh, I'm great. Thanks for taking the time to call in.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Okay, so I guess we'll just jump right in. It's Jacklyn Paulette from Requiem, vocals and guitar. So where are you calling from today?
I am calling from on the road right now, back from L.A. to Santa Cruz.
Awesome. So how long was the tour? How was it?
It was good. We played not too long ago. We played in L.A. a couple weeks ago. So that was fun. Actually, 2 months ago.
And you guys are from Santa Cruz.
I'm coming back from a photo shoot right now.
Oh, very cool. So you guys are originally from Santa Cruz, right?
Yeah.
So how was it coming up in the music scene there, especially being a rock and metal band?
Well, our style of music isn't very popular in the Santa Cruz scene, so we're mostly playing like Greater Bay Area and LA, Southern California area and stuff. But we do have our CD release show coming up on October 25th, and that'll be in Santa Cruz, the Catalyst, which is like the main venue that bands play at around there. So that's been nice. That's going to be great.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. The new album, by the way, is The Unexplainable Truth. If the listeners want to check it out, it features 14 brand new songs, and it'll be available everywhere on October 28th. You said your style of music isn't that popular around there. What is your style of music? Because you guys incorporate orchestral elements and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, our style of music's pretty all over the place, but it's cool because it's like basically elements of metal and punk and hard rock and stuff. And basically, you know, we'll leave that to the listeners to decide too as well.
Yeah, so do you find it difficult that there's so many, you know, there's death metal, thrash metal, black metal. Is that difficult to, you know, figure out for your own, you know, band identity, what kind of music you're making?
Yeah, basically we want to just try and appeal to a wider range of people. We don't want to be stuck in just one little, like, one genre specifically. That's how we're going about doing it. And it doesn't exactly fit in with all the smaller genres, the subgenres going around our hometown. But we still have people that are super interested in us there and stuff. But it's nice either way.
Yeah, of course. So tell me about the album. What should people expect when they listen to it?
They should definitely expect some high energy, awesome songs that are I'm really stoked on it all. I think everyone's gonna like how energetic they are, and how they're still pretty technical too, while appealing to a wider range of an audience. So I think people will be excited for that.
Yes, of course. And you do the guitars in the band as well as vocals. How did you get started with the guitar, and who were some of your influences?
I started playing guitar when I was 10 years old, and my influences are Jimi Hendrix, because the first song I ever learned was his version of the national anthem.
Awesome.
And then Ace Frehley of Kiss, and Mr. Gates of Avenged Sevenfold.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm a huge fan of especially Ace and Jimmy. You were a huge, big Kiss fan back in the day then?
Oh, yeah. My very first concert was Kiss when I was 2.5 years old. So I was pretty much born into it.
Which tour was that? Do you remember?
I don't remember the tour. I think I was too young to remember.
You're lucky. I'm a huge Kiss fan.
But,
you know.
I know it was like one of the, it might have been the last tour that Ace really ever played in.
So, okay, probably Dynasty.
Yeah, I think that was it, actually.
That's very cool. So Jimi Hendrix, when did you discover him? With the Are You Experienced?
Well, my parents basically were super into Jimi Hendrix. And so they would always have Jimi Hendrix playing at the house and stuff when I was growing up. And so what really caught my attention was his version of the national anthem. Because I used to sing the national anthem for Little League baseball when I was in local teams and stuff.
Okay.
For the opening days of the game. So I always liked that. And so when I heard his version of it, it really caught my attention. And I wanted to play just like him.
Well, yeah, I'd imagine. It's an amazing performance. So getting back to Requiem, I just talked to Carla and Heidi from Butcher Babies last week, and I'm not comparing Requiem to Butcher Babies, but, you know, they both have female band members. I just wanted to ask, do you feel like is some sexism in the metal community when it comes to females in bands?
Definitely. There's, you know, people don't take female musicians as seriously, and I know that we're all trying to change that, and so that can get pretty annoying. I've fallen victim to it a few times over the years. You know, just people thinking that you're the roadie or people let you carry all that equipment. Like, and it's just, it gets pretty annoying after a while. It's like, no, I'm actually in the band, not the merch girl, not the roadie.
So how do you react to it?
I just basically tell them the truth. I'm like, hey, I'm not any of those things. I'm in the band. This is what I do. I'm a musician. I've been doing it my whole life. And so I just have to always explain myself to them. And that's pretty old. And so I'm hoping that I soon won't have to explain that anymore.
Well, yeah, that would definitely be nice. I mean, it's weird that people think that because of your gender, you have, you know, different abilities. If you've been playing, you know, guitar the same amount of time as a male, that for some reason mm-hmm. you're lesser. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah. I don't see it, but it is what it is.
Yeah. Well, you know, I hope it starts to get better.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely.
So tell me, are there any bands that you have on a wish list that you would love to tour with?
Oh, definitely. I would love to tour with either AFI or Avenged Sevenfold. Even Marilyn Manson. Like, those are my favorites. So I'd be on if we do that.
Yeah, all great acts. Do you find that it's difficult to, when you're making your music, to put in influences from other people without, you know, kind of copying or ripping off?
No, it hasn't been too difficult. We're all pretty like solid songwriters, and we all have our own ideas that we come up with. But, you know, we obviously get influenced by people, but we never feel like we're copying anybody or anything.
No, and I'm not saying you guys are. I don't believe you are. It's just, if I was making music and I was listening to, let's say, Peter Criss drum and I was playing the drums, it would be hard for me not to do it like that. So I find it very, you know, impressive that you guys can, you know, incorporate influences in your own unique style.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. So is Requiem going to be on tour again soon for the new album?
Yeah, we're looking at some stuff for 2015, probably national tours and probably going to Europe early 2015. And right now we're just going to be finishing out the year with some shows here and there. We have like 10 shows booked right now and more coming. So that'll be helping to support our new album. But really it's just we're going to find out what we're going to do as soon as the album comes out and we see how that goes.
It should be great. Now, have you guys toured outside of the States before?
No, not yet.
Okay, so I was going to ask if you found that the audiences were different there, so I guess it'll be a new experience.
Definitely.
Very cool. So the album, again, is The Unexplainable Truth. Everybody listening, 14 new songs. Make sure to go check it out on October 28th in all stores everywhere. It's being released by Cleopatra Records. I'm very excited for the album. Thank you so much for taking the time to call in.
Oh, of course, and thank you.
So anything you want to say about the album or any last comments to everybody listening?
You basically covered that, but once again, you know, be sure to look out for our music video too, because that's going to be coming out pretty soon, around the same time as the album is, and so, that'll be for our song, Sticks and Stones and Her Lovely Bones, and, yeah, so we put a lot of effort into both the album and the music video, so I can't wait for everyone to hear it.
All right, awesome. Thanks so much. Take care.
You too. Thank you.
Bye. Jacklyn Paulette from Requiem, folks. Awesome, awesome stuff. Really nice person, too. You can tell she really loves rock and roll music. She loves doing it for the music, and she has a real passion for this genre. So it was great to have her on. Remember, new record and music video through Cleopatra Records. Go to the YouTube channel, youtube.com/Cleopatra Records, and it's awesome. I mean, I was just watching the video now. That was the song Sticks and Stones and Her Lovely Bones, and I'm glad I threw that on. I just kind of thought of it literally as I was recording. That wasn't one of those gags. It's kind of like I tweeted the other day when bands are on stage and they sit there saying, you know what? We're past the time limit, folks, but we're going to keep on playing. That wasn't one of those moves. It just kind of, unless the band is doing it for real and they've actually passed the time limit, then that's acceptable. And that's kind of what I did. Am I rambling? I think I'm rambling. Anyway, let's get into some listener calls. This is, we actually have the phone lines open right now. And for future reference, I missed the one on November 1st, but if you want to call into the next call-in show, they're on the 1st of every month. So December 1st, and I will give out the number a couple times throughout these calls. Because, you know, it's not live, so it doesn't really matter if you guys have the number now. But it is on facebook.com/Cassius Show. So December 1st, another call-in show. And I hope to hear a lot of you guys on it. And new people, people from last time. It should be a lot of fun. So let's start taking some calls. Hello, caller.
Cassius.
Hey, how's it going? Who's calling?
Chuck Bailey.
Chuck, how you doing, man?
What's up?
Good to talk to you. It's been a long time that we've known each other through Facebook here.
That and Twitter and whatnot. But I have my wife is telling me that these international calls are killing us.
Are they?
So I have to make it really, really quick.
Okay.
Okay, so a question and two song requests, all right?
All right, let's hear it.
I'm hearing that... of course, Alice Cooper's opening for Motley Crue, right?
Yes.
And I'm hearing that Cooper's set list began at 50 minutes, and now it's 2 hours. Is there any truth to that?
Really? Wow, I actually haven't heard of this. You know, it wouldn't surprise me because I think a lot of the audience is there for Alice Cooper. Other than the fact that it's Motley's last tour, I feel like it feels like, you know, they don't have a huge draw right now.
Curious, too, that Motley Crue is in, what, their 50s, late 50s, and Alice Cooper is mid-60s.
Yeah, I think he's about 65, nearly 70.
He's never mentioned the word retirement or farewell tour or any of that. And it's Motley's so-called, you know, final tour.
Right. Well, I think that the one that... The band that's wanted to retire is the one that is. At least for me.
Well, Mick Mars is not in any shape to do another 10 years of touring. I wouldn't think.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't think he's in the shape to do any more touring after this. And that's not a knock at the guy.
Yeah, exactly. and the chemistry of the band is not cohesive and not conducive to them doing another 10 years together, you know. So
that's right, and it's a shame for the fans, but you know,
drop the curtain when the time's right, I guess. But anyway, I hear that Alice Cooper is opening every show with LORA.
Oh yeah, well, perfect. And I love it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also hear that he's doing Department of Youth on and off.
Very nice.
Yeah,
I'm trying to get in talks to interview him when he comes here. He's here with that show on November 18th, so hopefully I'll be able to work something out. And by the way, no hate against Motley Crue.
Yeah, absolutely not. But I mean, God love him. Seeing him November 5th, you know, like 2 weeks before you, something like that.
Right. Yeah, and that's on my birthday too.
Yep.
Awesome.
November 5th. And then the song request would be "Hello, Ray" and "Department of Youth." Either one.
Okay, I can do that.
Any version.
All right. Listen, Chuck, thank you so much, man. It's great to talk to you.
Fantastic.
All right. Take care.
Hey, keep doing what you're doing, man.
Thanks so much. Bye.
All right.
Hey, Cassius.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, Mitch LaFon.
Mitch, what's going on?
Not much. So, what are we calling in for tonight?
We're doing a kind of hanging out, taking calls, and song request type show. Just, you know, talking about whatever. We got some topics come up already about, you know, Motley Crue. And, yeah, just talking about whatever. So, how's it going?
Good. You're quite a hit when you come on and co-host the one-on-one show. So thank you for that. And you know, we're talking Steel Panther and Judas Priest on the upcoming Metal Raps episode, which is always good.
Oh, nice.
You're a big fan of Steel Panther, I gather.
Oh, a huge fan. Posters all over the wall.
Ha! Because they look like pretty women.
That's right. Yeah, the closest I can get. Well, so I'm actually seeing them.
Oh, when are they coming through your town?
They're doing a thing called the Halloween Howler for the local rock station, and they're performing. Danko Jones is going to be there and a couple other bands, so I'll see them there.
You're a big Danko Jones fan, right?
Yeah, for sure. I've got a sticker on my laptop and all.
Oh, God. I don't get them, but maybe I should check them out a bit more. So what's going on in the Motley Crue world?
Somebody was calling in asking about – they heard that Alice Cooper's set was taken – from 50 minutes to 2 hours on the Motley tour. So they were asking about that. I'm not sure if that's true. Have you heard about this?
Well, you know, that doesn't make much sense for the simple reason that even an Alice Cooper show is not 2 hours long. It's about 75 to 90 minutes. So even if he did a full show, I don't understand why he would go longer than he would in a, you know, in a club gig. So
that's right.
It seems kind of strange. And was there any reason for that given?
I don't know. It was just a rumor going around on Facebook and stuff. So
mostly because Vince Neil can't sing that long.
Yeah, that would probably have something to do with it.
Yeah. Have you heard the new 6 a.m. Album?
No, not the new one. How is that?
It's actually pretty good. It's very old school. It has some disco runs in there, and it's got some you know, glam metal, and it's got a bit of funk. It's certainly not a heavy metal record. It's very I don't know. It's like Donna Summers meets Kiss or something like that. It's interesting. I like it. I put it on and was driving around downtown. I actually put it on as I drove out to see the Blaze Bailey show the other day, and it's a good funky record. I think Motley fans, you know, if you're really into the whole Motley sound, will be somewhat disappointed. But okay. I think it's a great album. You know, great album.
Yeah, I like what I've heard of theirs. I heard, you know, obviously Lies of the Beautiful People, and I like their acoustic record that they did.
Yeah, that was great, wasn't it?
Very good, yeah. The vocals were insane, and I like that Nikki Sixx doesn't make it all about him. He lets the other members shine as well.
As they should, you know. James Michael is a great, great talent, and DJ Ashbaugh is an incredible talent. He just got sort of pigeonholed because he decided to replace Slash and Guns N' Roses, and much like Tommy Thayer, that gets heat for no reason. But
that's right, yeah. They aren't the most famous. They aren't the most loved people in rock and roll, let's say.
No, and have you had a chance to listen to our Eddie Trunk interview?
I listened to the first 25 minutes, and then I realized that I had an interview, so I had to stop it. I just ended the part right after Steve Coronel. Very interesting stuff, and where can people find that if they want to hear it?
Oh, well, you know, the one-on-one with Mitch LaFon is on iHeartRadio, Spreaker, TuneIn, Stitcher, especially if you have an Android phone, Stitcher is the place where you want to go, iTunes, and eventually it'll be up on YouTube. But I have a feeling that the Eddie Trunk is going to make me a pariah in the Kiss world, because a few things were said that were perhaps not as kind as they could have been.
Well, it's a good thing I'm just the co-host then, in the beginning.
Yeah, but you heard most of it. I don't think anything was bad. I mean, if you heed the chat about that guy who got arrested was probably some of the tougher stuff we said. So
yeah, well, I didn't think it was that bad. But then again, we all know the Kiss campus can be extremely sensitive, especially when it comes to podcasts.
Yeah, well, because podcasts aren't real, even though kind of like 40 million people tune into a podcast each and every day around, the States and Canada. So,
well, listen, thanks for calling in, Mitch. I appreciate it. And everybody check out One-on-One with Mitch LaFon.
Yeah, and of course, please do. And of course, Metal Raps with Mitch LaFon, Mark Striegel, and Mitch Joel. Another great little one. So check both of those out. iTunes, iHeart, Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn. I don't know. World Domination is next.
All right. Awesome. Thanks, Mitch. Take care.
Thank you, Cassius.
See ya. Well, we're still taking calls, folks, so feel free to call in. And for future reference, by the way, the call-in number is 1-310-651-6328. That's 310-651-6328.
Cassius, are you in California now?
I wish. I actually just signed up to get, I figured out a way to get a California number so it looks better.
Oh, okay. No, I always thought you were up in like Nova Scotia or someplace like that.
Yeah, I just moved actually across Canada to Alberta now. But yeah, who's calling, by the way?
Oh, yeah. No, I got your number off of the FAQ. My name is Dean, but I go by Class 1.
Oh, cool. Hey, man.
Hey. Yeah, no, I've been listening to your podcast for a long time now, and I just want to say that, you know, I really appreciate your shows and everything you've been doing. I mean, for a kid so young as yourself, it's a pretty amazing accomplishment.
Thank you so much, man. I really appreciate that. You know, it's great that KISS fans are still listening, you know, even though it's not just KISS content.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, well, the thing about KISS is, like, it's just such an iconic band.
Yeah.
And, like, all of their albums from, like, the first album to, you know, their last album have all been kind of different, but they've all pretty much kicked ass.
Oh, well, for sure.
Yeah.
How long have you been a fan?
Yeah. Well, I've been a fan, let's see, oh, probably for about 30 years.
That's insane. So have you ever gotten out of KISS because they released something you didn't like?
No, not really. I mean, I really didn't like the whole Carnival of Souls thing, but that was kind of like short-lived because, you know, they came out with, you know, Ace and Peter came in with the MTV Unplugged show, and then the reunion concert happened all kind of around that same period of time. So I never really dropped off the bandwagon with them.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, the first concert I ever saw was the Asylum tour. So, I never really got to see like the originals back when they were in their heyday.
Okay.
So when the reunion show did come around, that was like, you know, that was like the greatest show I'd ever seen.
Yeah, it must have blown the minds of the fans, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So
I mean, it was like the biggest tour on the planet.
Yeah, absolutely. KISS was back. So what do you think of KISS today, like what they're doing now?
Well, you know, it's kind of disappointing that Paul's voice is just so shitty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The last tour I saw was the Psycho Circus tour.
Okay.
And, you know, when Tom was there and it took over for Ace and all that. I mean, I enjoyed the album still, but I really didn't have any interest in watching them see live. But I saw in your post you were looking for a topic that people could talk about. And there was some talk on the FAQ about, comparing the non-makeup era album with the classic KISS sound. And I was always kind of curious, what exactly was the classic KISS sound? Because when I listened to the original KISS albums, they all sound just like completely different to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
The first KISS album was totally different than Hotter Than Hell. And Hotter Than Hell came out, those two albums just sounded like two totally different, well, not totally different bands, but it was just like a totally different sound.
Mm-hmm.
And then yeah, Dress to Kill that came out, which was also very different. So, I mean, when you take a look back and you say, okay, well, the classic KISS sound is probably alive, because KISS is, you know, always known as more of a live band, and it gives them the opportunity to put, like, the greatest hits of the first three albums under
right.
the same kind of production in the same kind of setting. But,
well,
I mean, again, it's a live album, so you can't really say that was necessarily the classic KISS sound, because the next album that came out with was Destroyer, which was completely different than anything they've ever done before.
Right, very different. Well, what I think is the classic KISS sound, I think mostly it's Ace. You know, I mean, when you really look at it, the drummers have been changed through the years, and it's still, you know, it's still KISS. Of course it doesn't sound like Peter Criss, but it's still KISS. But when you really look at it, or listen to it, I mean, at least for me, I think the classic sound is those riffs. And, you know, Paul's included because he was also on guitar, but I think that it's Ace that really helps make the KISS sound. When you listen to Deuce, Strutter, it's mostly the guitar that's driving the songs, and that was Ace there. So in my opinion, he has a huge, huge, huge hand to play in the classic KISS sound.
Yeah, that's true too. But, you'd have to go Peter Criss in the mix too, because
all of them.
Because when Anton Pink stepped in on Dynasty, well, I mean, obviously they're going in a different musical direction anyways.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I mean,
yeah, I don't know.
It's the perfect mixture of what they had.
Yeah, it was. When I think back on it, if you want to like nail down like a studio record that probably like captured like the classic Kiss sound, it was probably Rock and Roll Over, because you know, they always said that when they went into the studio to record that record, they wanted to capture sort of that live sound from Kiss Alive, and they kind of, you know, I think that was probably when they really captured the moment of, well, you could say, okay, yeah, all these tunes are really strong, and it really sort of captures like that whole thing. And Peter Criss was still, I mean, he wasn't as great as he was back on the first three albums, but he still held his own on Rock and Roll Over. And I think that album probably, you know, in my opinion, would encapsulate the whole classic Kiss sound.
Listen, man, thanks so much for your call. I appreciate you calling in and all the support of the podcast.
Hey, yeah, sure thing, Cassius. Hey, you take care, man, and keep putting it out there, and I'll keep listening to your show.
Thanks so much. Take care. Bye.
All right, bye.
Hello.
Is this Cassius?
Yes.
I'd like to ask you a question.
Sure. Who's calling?
This is Alina Christie from Halifax.
Hey, what's going on?
What has seven arms and sucks?
I got no idea.
Def Leppard.
Oh, how dare you.
Is this like on air?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow. Amazing. Okay, cool. Well, I just wanted to tell you my joke. Miss you lots.
All right, hey, take care. It's good to hear from you.
Yeah, you too.
All right, bye.
Bye.
Friend from my old school there. Figured they'd call in because I've been spamming the shit out of my Facebook and Twitter with this. But, you know, thanks again for all the calls, everybody. It's been very cool to hear from the listeners. You know, I hear from them all the time on, you know, social media. But hearing from some listeners on the phone and being able to hear a voice to the face is very, very interesting. It's not something that I usually have. And now that I've finally figured out a way to have the call-in show where people can actually just call in from their landline or cell phone, is perfect. I shot the sheriff, but I didn't shoot no deputy. Oh, no, oh. I shot the sheriff, but I didn't shoot no deputy. Bonjour.
Bonjour, Cassius.
Comment ça va?
Ça va bien, et toi?
Good. I'm not going to speak any more French because I'm just horrible at it, but how you doing?
Oh, I'm okay. So I just saw your sign, your posting to call on your show.
Yeah, so, and we're on the air right now.
That is what I am doing. And first of all, I want to say what a great fan of yours I am.
Oh, thanks.
And I love every minute, second of your podcasts, etc. So I want the world to know this. I mean, listen to this young man. He is absolutely fantastic.
Oh, thank you so much.
What I would like to know is, what are your future plans for podcasting?
Basically, it would be to keep working on what I have now and building it, and then being able to make somewhat of a living off of this, along with another career choice, be it comedy, video, or audio editing, something like that. But for the podcast to be a part of my life, you know, for the remainder of my life, or as long as I can do it or it's popular, that's the plan. You know, I just want to do it as long as possible and, you know, make some kind of money off it at least.
Well, I think the way you're going, that's a great possibility. You just keep going as steady as you are and more, and the doors will open.
That's Thank you so sure. much.
Okay. Well, good luck with the show. And is it very nice? This feels so professional. I can call to someone's show.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's the first time, and there have been a couple of hiccups, but it's working. So thanks for calling.
Good. So good luck with the show.
All right. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye now.
Shout out to old Jews and old rules. New blacks with new stacks. I already been the king. Retroact, I'm just bringing it back like Jordan Pax. New money, they looking down on me. Blue bloods, they trying to clown on me. You can turn up your nose, high society. Never gonna turn down the homie. Knock, knock, I'm at your neighbor house. Straight cash, I bought your neighbor out. You should come to the house for me. Come and see what your new neighbor about. Yellow Lambo in the driveway. 135, I'm on the highway. French Sinatra on my soul, no. Loud as fuck, I did it my way. Me and Soul before the album
drop. Hello.
Hi.
Hey, who's calling?
This is Andrew.
Andrew Kiss?
Yep.
What's going on, man? How you doing?
Oh, not too much. How are you doing?
I'm good. Just taking some calls here and happy to hear from the listeners. What's going on?
Oh, not too much. You said you were taking song requests?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Before that, I guess I just had a quick question. I don't know if you probably already answered this a dozen times, but was there any like moment interviewing an artist that like was surreal to you, like, holy crap, I'm interviewing so-and-so, or like, I've made it this far? I don't know.
Yeah, no, definitely. It was, I think it was when Eric Singer called in, and, you know,
yeah. It
was incredible, because I was just sitting there on my live show, and I get a message from him, which, you know, that in itself blows my mind still whenever that happens, and he's just like, you know, how do I call in? And we ended up having like an hour and a half or almost 2 hour interview. And it was insane. That was when I really realized that, this was reaching some people at least, and it reached enough people to get me to talk to one of my heroes. So that was my favorite moment in this entire thing so far.
That's pretty incredible. And it's also amazing how you can keep your cool when interviewing these people. Cause like, I'd probably be dry heaving on the phone with them. I'd be so nervous. So.
Well, thanks. I mean, the thing about that is I let all of that happen before I answer the phone. Like when I'm sitting there, yeah, when I'm sitting there waiting for the call and the call comes, my stomach drops.
Yeah.
I take a deep breath, brace myself. And the second I answer, I'm in podcast mode and it's just another person I'm interviewing. I can't think about it. Because if I think about this is so-and-so from, you know, Megadeth or Kiss, I'll start to freak out. So, you know, that's how I try to keep my cool.
Well, you're a real professional, man.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So you have a song request.
Yeah, I was wondering if I can hear Into Crypts of Rays by Celtic Frost.
Yeah, I'll definitely check that out and throw it in for you. Thanks for calling.
Oh, thanks for answering my call.
All right. Take care.
You too. Bye.
Shut up.
there you have it, folks. The very first listener call-in show. In my opinion, that went fantastic. I mean, I had quite a few calls throughout the entire evening, and it was a lot of fun. I want to thank everybody for calling in. Another heads up, the next call-in show, as I mentioned, is December 1st, 2014. So get your questions ready a month in advance and make sure to call in to the show. The number is, let me just dig up the number here. I don't have all the stuff in front of me, folks. It's not like I'm at the Adam Carolla Studios where I have, you know, all this stuff right in front of me at my disposal. But the number is 1-310-651-6328. That is a business number that will not be answered outside business hours, aka the first of every month. I am not stupid enough to give out my home or cell number on the show. But yes, the first of every month, feel free to call in and ask a question. And just so you guys know, if it just rings and rings and rings, stay on the line. It will get answered. And if it hangs up, try calling back. So again, thank you to everybody who called in. And thank you for listening to me on the Adam Carolla Show and on this show. And I just wanted to say, this is what I love to do, people. I don't have a whole lot else going on. I don't play sports. I don't jump off bridges and get hammered every weekend. That's every other weekend. But every weekend, I'm doing this. And this is what I absolutely love to do. And I have a feeling that it is something that will bring me a lot of good stuff in my life. And already has, by the way. I mean, the amount of positivity that's happened through the show is mind-blowing. The shows, I should say, including Creatures of the Net and That Reporter Kid Speaks, and now the Cassius Morris Show. It is just incredible. It's mind-blowing that a guy in his basement broadcast center, which is a hell of a lot nicer, by the way, which I'm going to have to do a video tour of, but a guy like me, sitting here in his basement, in his home studio, can broadcast to people around the world. Like I said, I got fan mail from Tino from the Netherlands. I get people from China listening. When I was 12, actually 11 or 12 or 13, I had listeners check in from Antarctica. I mean, it's incredible. So thank you guys so much for tuning in. And this, again, is what I love to do. I find that when I don't get the respect I'm looking for, and when I get nasty comments online and stuff like that, which I now ignore. I have quit message boards for my own sake. quit it like a drug because I keep going to use them. But when I get these negative comments online, it fuels me more. And when I get negative comments in person or on the phone dealing with managers or publicists or whatever, it fuels me more because I just say, all right, see if you're going to be saying that in 10 years. Because if things keep going the way they're going, folks, I feel like I could get a lot of good out of this, and possibly I could be training for my career right now. As I say these words, this could be career training. So, sorry for going off on a tangent, which, you know, I can do whenever I want, really, because it's my show, but I still feel bad. It just feels great. And I have no intention of stopping anytime soon, and ever since I switched to the Cassius Morris Show and combined my shows, I feel like it was just the missing piece. Things were going quite well, but they weren't going exactly how I wanted them to go. And now I feel like they are. Things are falling into place. I took a break over the summer, and now I'm back. Every Wednesday, I'm back. So check me out on Facebook, facebook.com/Cassius Show, C-A-S-S-I-U-S, if you can't read what you're listening to right now. Which makes no sense. I mean, the player you're listening to right now, be it YouTube, which is also available at youtube.com/Cassius Morris, be it Spreaker, which is the Cassius Morris Show on Spreaker, be it Stitcher, which is also the Cassius Morris Show. And damn it, will you guys change that photo of me? If you want to go to Stitcher and search up my name, and you will see my page on Stitcher Radio. God awful screenshot of me from my second ever YouTube video that they found online, or actually my third. They just kind of looked up me on Google and clicked the first thing they could find. I've asked them to change it. They won't. Anyway, you can also find me on iTunes and thatreporterkid.com. We're sponsored by Audible, folks. Go to audibletrial.com/kid and get a free audiobook on the house through Amazon. And speaking of Amazon, this is just working out so perfectly, thatreporterkid.com, click on the Amazon tab. It'll bring you through to Amazon to do some holiday shopping or whatever you want to get without extra cost. When you check out, it helps the show only if you click through the Amazon link. So that's thatreporterkid.com. The Amazon tab at the top of the page, click that and enjoy your holiday shopping. Maybe buy one of the records from one of the bands that was featured on the show today. And follow me on Twitter at Cassius Morris and the show at Cassius Show. So, wow, that was a lot in one lung, folks. Thank you so much again for listening. I'm your host, Cassius Morris, a.k.a. That Reporter Kid, for Jacklyn Paulette, Joakim from Sabaton, and all of my callers today saying, rock on.